from ghoulies and ghosties and long-legged beasties and things that go bump in the night. Good Lord, deliver us. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Seekers of the Supernatural. I'm your moderator, Tony Sparrow, with hosts Ed and Lorraine Warren. Tonight's program will be an exciting one, and it will include ghosties and beasties and things that go bump in the night. Tonight we're going to be speaking about one of the most horrific cases that the Warrens have ever investigated, the Amityville Horror. Now, Ed, can you tell me how you and Lorraine got involved in the Amityville Horror?
Well, it was Marvin Scott from Channel 5 news team. He was the anchor man at the time. And he had been involved with a haunting that we had investigated in Bloomfield, New Jersey. And he was impressed by this. So he gave us a ring and he said, we'd like you to come down and see what's going on in Amityville, Long Island. Now, this was not the Amityville Horror case at that time, you understand. Mm-hmm. This was just another haunted house, and we didn't even realize that six people had been murdered in that house of the Fayol family. So we said, sure, we'd come down there, and we did. And that was the beginning of an adventure which we'll never forget, a supernatural adventure. Mm-hmm. When we went into the house that day, we didn't realize that it was diabolically infested. And on a scale of 1 to 10, I would have to say that Amityville was a 10. I want to make it clear at the beginning of this program that Lorraine and I do not back up the movie or the book. Mm-hmm. It was much more horrific than either. You didn't have to take a literary license in a book or dramatic license in a movie. This case had everything. It had the monstrosities of the night which roamed that house, which infested it, which caused a young man to murder his whole family. Ronald DeFeo is now serving a six consecutive life sentences mm-hmm. at Dannemora Prison. But you know, Amityville Horror goes way back before the Lutz family, who moved in there and bought the house later mm-hmm. and were fled 28 days later. It goes back 6 months before the DeFeos were murdered. Mr. DeFeo mm-hmm. went up to Montreal, Canada. He went to a shrine where many miracles had occurred. A lot of people don't know this. He went to that shrine and he brought back from there a priest, an exorcist, who said masses in the house. Why? If this was a hoax that was created by the Lutz family, why 6 months before this man was murdered and his family was an exorcist in that house? While the priest was saying a mass and performing the exorcism rituals, candles were blowing out, doors were opening and closing, there were footsteps all around the house. Ronald DeFeo, who was the murderer of his family, fled the house. He didn't stay there. He did not want to stay there while the priest was in that house. What caused him to leave? Obsession? Possession? Who can say? We do know that this young man did murder every member of his family in that house, shot them to death. On November 13th, 1974, at 3:15 in the morning, he had a high-powered rifle. Now, when you see the photographs later, and these are the only pictures ever taken inside the Amityville Horror House, because Lorraine and I and just a handful of other investigators actually went in there. I've heard people on TV say, I was in that house, I investigated. They never were. Never they don't were. Have any evidence, they have no proof. Mm-hmm. We have the proof, and you'll see that proof tonight. Mm-hmm. They will see the only photographs ever taken in the house itself at the time of the investigation. And as the Lutzes left that home, completely furnished, they didn't take one thing with them. Mm-hmm. They left everything there and they went off to California. Because Father Pecoraro, who many people said did not exist, talked with Lorraine and I. He told us all the horrible things that happened to him. We sat with him, he was as close as I am to you, Tony, at dinner at Kathy Lutz's mother's home in Deer Park. He told me things that the public has never heard about. Mm-hmm. And tonight, we are going to endeavor to explain what really happened in that home.
Okay, Lorraine, I know you went in the house and you experienced things, mm-hmm. but can we just go over how you first were called into the house? Like, who was the gentleman that, or people that called you in? Was it the Lutzes that called you in?
No, it was not, Tony. It was Marvin Scott who called us in. He told us there had been a tragedy in that home. He didn't go into detail regarding it. He told us that it was a prominent family. Mm-hmm. He also told us during that very first conversation that the family that were living there at the present time had fled and left all of their possessions behind. And their viewers were very interested in the history of that house and what exactly might be wrong with the home. That's how we first became involved. Mm-hmm. Now, I had to tell Marvin Scott at that time that there was no way that we could go in that home without an invitation and permission from the family, which came very readily. Mm-hmm. But realize, when we met with George Lutz, not Kathy, because Kathy and the children were not there. When we met with George, he wouldn't go anywhere near the house. He met us at a pizza parlor and really? Sat with us and talked because he was so frightened.
Well, I understand that George wasn't really a kind, he was a no-nonsense kind of a guy,
He was
right?
really a no-nonsense man,
George,
don't
George Lutz was an ex-Marine. He was a karate expert. He ran around with motorcycle gangs. We're not talking about any altar boy here. We're talking about a rough, tough guy who, after 28 days in that house, fled, left everything behind, took his wife and children, and went off to California.
See, he was the type of person, Tony, that felt like he was had to always be in control. He would go out on the landings. It was three stories high. The home is very beautiful. The interior of the home is very formal and it's very beautiful. Mm-hmm. And he would go out and he would take his fist and he would tell what was there or command what was there to come out so he could fight it. Because as far as he was concerned, he was very skeptical regarding the fact that anything paranormal was going on. At the time that this first began, he found it difficult because of his background to even believe in a God, never mind believe that something of this nature was taking place. Mm-hmm. But I have to say this, the Amityville case affected our personal lives more than any case we ever worked on.
Really?
It was, yes.
How, in what way?
Well, it was to follow us home the very first day, the very first night that Ed and I went to that home. It was the middle of the night when we came home. And I had contacted many priests. I was fearful, but Tony, I didn't know what I was fearful of. I mean, it was just another case. It wasn't the Amityville Horror. So I really didn't know what I was so fearful of. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, I took with me a relic of a very pious priest, and I asked many clergy of different faiths to enter that home with us in spirit and to, you know, their prayers to protect us. Mm-hmm. But when we arrived back at our home about 2-3 o'clock in the morning, Ed took his briefcase and things that he had with him and he brought them down to his office. Now, I got in bed and I took a book to bed with me on the life of Padre Pio, the priest whose relic I carried, a man who I have tremendous devotion to, mm-hmm. very holy and pious monk priest from Italy, Giovanni Rotunda, Italy. And something about that cheerful room wasn't so cheerful anymore. Mm. It felt ominous to me.
Mm-hmm. Actually, Ed, I understand that there were other people in the house with you, but did other people take photographs?
No. It was only our photographer from the New England Society for Psychic Research that was taking pictures. And we took over 200 photographs that day, which I am very happy about. Because, as I said, these are the only photographs ever taken mm-hmm. in that home. And I think when we get to next week's program, or the next show, I should say, that when they see these psychic pictures, one of a spirit child gazing out of one of the bedrooms where the children were murdered. And then one of Padre Pio, the man that Lorraine is talking about, who was a stigmatist mm-hmm. for over 50 years, had fought the devil many times in his life.
Can you explain stigmata to us.
Stigmata is a person who suffers the wounds of Christ, the crucifixion of the hands, the legs, the feet, the crowns on the head. Uh-huh. But he suffered this for over 50 years and fought the devil, not only spiritually, but physically many times. That's why Lorraine had this feeling that she should call on him to help us in this house. Mm-hmm. And we didn't even know how bad it was that day, but as she said, George Lutz wouldn't even go to that home. He said, there's no way I'm going into the house. And when I asked him at this restaurant where we met him, I said, Mr. Lutz, what happened to you in that house? He didn't say anything. He just looked at me. He said, you know. I said, I don't know, Mr. Lutz. I said, what happened to you in the house? He looked at me again. He said, you know. I said, I really don't know. I was getting a little irritated because I wanted to find out what kind of experiences this man had, but he was actually afraid to talk about what happened for fear mm-hmm. that it would happen again mm-hmm. because at his mother-in-law's house at Deer Park, when Kathy himself and the mother-in-law would start talking about what happened there, things would happen in the house at Deer Park. In fact,
because
George
of the
and Kathy
recognition.
Levitated in that house, too.
Yes,
they levitated both.
They had phenomena follow them from Amityville. Now, Tony, we know this happens. We know that even ourselves involved in research, that you go to a location where haunting phenomena is going on, active phenomena, and you leave and go home, and you give it a lot of recognition, you listen to the tapes, and like while you're still programmed, then
something can't come to you.
Yes.
In fact, when we went into the house, Tony, Lorraine went with the camera crew, and you'll see the pictures coming up now. If we can show a picture of the Amityville home as it was, and then you'll see the interior of the house, and where I had a terrible experience down in the basement. Mm-hmm. And what had occurred was, as a religious demonologist, I do carry a crucifix, I carry holy water.
Right.
These are the weapons of Catholicism where the diabolical are concerned. Mm-hmm. And it's my intention to go into a home like that and to provoke what's there. Mm-hmm. Because I'm not a clairvoyant. I can't see clairvisually or hear clairaudiently. I must provoke what's there.
Okay, what are we looking at here?
This, of course, is the sign of Amityville here, which actually means a friendly village.
Oh, boy.
But unfortunately, it wasn't too friendly after a while. Uh-huh. If we could see the next picture now of the house.
Okay.
And you'll see the home as it was when we investigated it. You know, they've changed the architecture of the home, the design of it, taking the windows out, changed the numbers and everything. And I don't blame them because of the vandals.
Yes. Uh-huh. Oh, we don't blame them.
So in other words, people wouldn't even recognize it today, huh? Mm.
Now, in the book, it tells about the well being inside the house. There's the well you see right there at the corner.
Right in the front there?
Right in the front there.
That's it, Tony.
And that doorway was the doorway that George Lutz said had been ripped open one night. Mm-hmm. That's right in the front there. And we could see markings and so forth on the door. But remember, when he made statements like, we walked up the staircase, and this is the way they put it in the book. We walked up the staircase, and suddenly the banister exploded before our very eyes. Mm-hmm. Well, when we went into that house, there was no banister that exploded.
Right.
What they should have said was, as they walked up the staircase, the banister suddenly exploded through telepathic hypnosis.
Okay.
In other words, if we were in a haunted house right now, Tony, we might see that table explode, and yet a couple of minutes later, it would be fully intact. Mm-hmm. It was a telepathic projection to us, bypassing the physical eye and going into the mind's eye or the third eye. They didn't explain that.
Okay. If we could have that next slide, and Ed will explain, and Lorraine will explain exactly what we're looking at here. That would be
good. As we go through the slides, here's the boathouse.
That's the rear of the Amityville home. Mm-hmm. And as you can see, this is extremely valuable property. Believe it or not, that home, Tony, was sold for $50,000 to this family. Now, you're looking at the boathouse right on the Amityville River, and up in the back is the house itself.
Yeah, but
that
this is where the Shinnecock Indians had an enclosure.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That's where it all started, with the Shinnecock Indians. They had an enclosure right there where they put the sick, the mad, and the dying.
Uh-huh.
Demonic spirits, evil spirits, are drawn to the sufferings of human beings. And this already had an aura of disaster about it.
Now, in the background there, that is the back of the Amityville home.
The white building.
The white building, yes.
Now, if we can see the next picture.
The next picture, I believe, is going to go into some of the interior shot.
No, this is
John Ketchum. This is a statue of John
Without
Ketchum.
A head.
Well, John Ketchum, John Ketchum was the man who built a small cottage right there where the Amityville home is at the present time. And after his, or prior to his death, mm-hmm. he had said that he wanted to be buried on that land. Now, he was ousted from Salem for his mm-hmm. witchcraft practices. Okay. So he didn't have exactly a good track record. Now, people that purchased the property after his death claimed that haunting phenomena occurred there. Mm-hmm. Now, it was moved, Tony. It was moved to a location a couple of blocks away, and the thing is that Amityville home was built there in 1928, and no family that ever lived in that home was ever a happy family.
See, on the monitor, it'll be coming up shortly. If Ed, you could explain what this picture is.
Oh, yes. I told you before how Mr. DeFeo had gone up to Montreal, Canada, at the St. Joseph Shrine, and brought back a priest with him to exorcise the house. Mm-hmm. But he also had special blessed statues made that he surrounded the house with. Now, why did he do that? He was not known for being a pious man in any means. Mm-hmm. He brought him back because something very horrifying was going on in that house. That's why the exorcist, and that's why these statues. Mm-hmm.
And you know what, Tony? This is amazing. People were curious regarding why this family had religious statues all over the yard. And they inquired, and Mr. DeFeo Sr. told the neighbors that he had a devil on his back.
Mm-hmm. Now, you were called in by, you also, a newspaper man invited you in, too. What was his name? Oh, here's the picture of him now.
Oh, you mean Marvin Scott. That's Marvin Scott, Tony.
Okay, he was an anchor man on Channel 5.
On Channel 5.
Okay, so yes. He was there with his camera crew and everything?
Oh, yes. And his camera crew, who had filmed in combat assignments, became very badly affected in this house, had severe heart palpitations. Mm-hmm. In fact, a lot of people were very badly affected that night, that very first night in the home.
Mm-hmm. So the next picture, I think we're going to see George and Kathy.
Yes, there's George
and
Kathy.
I want you to look at this guy, Tony. Does he look like a guy that you'd want to fool around with? No,
no
way.
Not at all.
No.
George is a rough, tough guy,
yes.
And he doesn't leave behind everything he owns in this world just on a fluke or on a hope that somebody might write a book about a haunted house.
No, that's mm-hmm. for
Kathy
sure.
Kathy was as beautiful as he was tough.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And even today, she's a very religiously oriented woman.
Mm-hmm.
The Lutz family, if our viewers out there could know them as Lorraine and I knew them, we lived with them for 2 weeks out in California. They are a beautiful family.
Oh, now, how many children did they have?
They had three at the time. They have since had two more children. But Kathy, these were the first three, Tony, were Kathy's children.
Okay, there they are.
Yes, there's Chris and John and Missy. Now, Missy, the little girl in the middle, to talk to these young children as they would talk to Ed and I, very candidly sharing things with us, they were terrified of what was in that house.
Mm-hmm.
But the little girl, the youngest of the three children, was very candid about talking about her friends in Amityville, and what she was referring to would be this Jody the pig and like that, that would come in and sit on the rocking chair in her room and rock. To her, they were friends.
Now keep in mind that when we go into a home, you know, these people are telling us these horrible stories, but we have to ourselves experience this before we accept it.
Right.
We have to see it, we have to feel it. We have to know it's there before we say yes. This home is haunted.
Mm-hmm.
And this home was not haunted by anything human.
No.
It was inhuman. Many people ask us about that. It was inhuman, and then they say, well, people went in there later and lived there, and nothing ever happened to them. Well, who's to say that the house was not exorcised?
Okay, Ed, how do you know it was something inhuman versus something like an earthbound
spirit? By the powers.
By the powers of
Remember,
what was
the first
there.
Time I went in that house, I went downstairs into the basement. I used religious provocation. I ordered in the name of Jesus Christ what was there. I commanded it in that name of Christ to reveal its identity. Within seconds, mm-hmm. I could feel what I can only describe as being under a waterfall pressure, pushing me down to the floor. Then I could feel hundreds of pinpoints of electricity hitting my body. And then, as though they took a hot towel, wet towel, and dropped it right over my face, I couldn't breathe. Wow. That's the experience I had. And I went into what we call religious resistance. Mm-hmm. I then envisioned myself in a Christ-light as a Christian, as a Catholic. And I again commanded it to leave in the name of Jesus Christ. It immediately lifted off. Mm-hmm. I knew right at that point what we were dealing with. And I said to myself, I don't think I'll ever come back in this house again. Because I felt that a house isn't worth a person's life.
Now, this is during the period of time, Tony, what you're looking at, that I was asked if I would try to communicate something that was so dangerous for me to do.
Okay, so who's the gentleman in the middle?
That's Dr. Brian Riley, a parapsychologist from England, mm-hmm. and a very good friend of ours, and that's Marvin Scott.
Were there any other doctors or any other professionals in the house?
Dr. Yes. Alex Tanis.
Dr. Brian Riley, Dr. Alex Tanis, Carlos Osis was also in the home that night. There were many professional people in that home that night, Tony, given their evaluation.
This is a picture of the camera crew focusing in on Lorraine as she's coming up the stairs.
That's
but this
infrared.
Next shot.
That's an infrared shot.
These are infrared
yes,
shots.
It is okay. Infrared, yes.
This next shot will show Lorraine on a staircase where she was already picking up what I was experiencing downstairs.
Mm-hmm.
If we can see that next picture.
Okay, next one's coming up.
Okay, now, Tony, when Ed tells you about going down into the basement area, him and I separated at this point, and I'm going up the stairs. I don't realize that he is not behind me.
Mm-hmm.
And as I'm going up the stairs, Tony, it was the worst feeling. It was like I was going against a tremendous pressure that was on my body. I stopped on the landing mm-hmm. and held tight to the relic that was in my hand and asked for strength and direction in going forward. And it seemed like my prayers were answered. And at that point, I continued on up the few stairs and turned immediately to my left, mm-hmm. went into what was then known as the sewing room.
Okay, I think that shot's coming up.
Right there, Tony, yes. And I stood in the middle of the room. I looked at Marvin Scott and mm-hmm. I said, I hope this is as close to hell as I'll ever get. Mm-hmm.
This is the room where the priest heard the voice tell him to get out, where they seen the hundreds of flies. And even though I'm not a clairvoyant, I'm not a sensitive, when I walked into that room, I could feel it.
Mm-hmm.
Now you notice that in all these pictures,
yep.
everything is there. Ironing boards, curtains,
yes.
dishes, expensive furniture. You'll see the clothing of the children, their toys that they left behind.
Now, believe it or not, Tony, that is the bed that Mr. and Mrs. DeFeo were shot to death in.
You're kidding.
No, a lot of the furnishings in that home were from the DeFeo estate that the Lutzes purchased. So it showed where their belief system was.
This is also the bed from which George and Kathy found
themselves
levitating.
Oh, yeah.
They were about 2 feet from the ceiling, and George looked at Kathy and he said, do you believe this? And that's when mm-hmm. they fell to the bed again.
Oh,
now,
yes.
You told me before that the house was as if I had left my house this evening.
Exactly.
That's exactly how it was.
I think the next shot would probably illustrate.
There's some of the
freezer.
Foodstuffs in the freezer.
In the freezer.
I mean, they left behind everything. Everything to eat, everything to drink, all their clothing, their bedding.
Mm-hmm.
When we went to Deer Park, to Kathy's mother's home,
mm-hmm.
they were sleeping on mattresses on the floor.
Yes.
They had beds here. Look here, you see the towels, all the bathroom things.
The clothing, Tony.
Everything.
Rare collections they had inherited from grandparents, the deeds to their property, the baptismal records, their marriage certificates, nothing. They didn't take a thing other mm-hmm. than the clothes on their back when they fled that home.
Now, the next shot, I think, Ed, you told me was the red room?
Yes, this is what they mm-hmm. refer to as the red room. It's actually a cubby hole that goes in probably about 8 or 9 feet. It's about 7 foot high by 4 foot.
Mm-hmm.
But this is the room in which we believe Ronald DeFeo kept the items that he used in witchcraft.
Mm-hmm.
Witchcraft and rituals, drugs, played a big part
yes.
in the murders that occurred here. The next picture, you'll see some witchcraft items,
okay.
Things that Ronald DeFeo had in the house and so forth.
Are those some of the items right there?
Those are some of the items there you see. And we know that this young man was obsessed or possessed by something demonic. He hated his father, mm-hmm. but he loved his mother. He loved his sisters and his brothers. Why did he kill them? Mm-hmm. He said there was a dark form next to him that just kept him going. We call that a shadow ghost.
Shadow ghost. Mm-hmm.
And it was this here that goaded Ronald DeFeo into killing every member of his family. This is a large ceramic lion that Kathy had given George for Christmas. And on two occasions, this played an important role. One night, they woke up around 3:15 when they heard what they described as the marching band downstairs. They felt a heavy weight on their legs. George put the light on, and it was this statue on their leg. They thought it was their large dog.
Oh,
on another occasion, they were going down the staircase, he was, mm-hmm. to investigate the sound of the marching band.
The staircase, I think, is the next shot, in fact.
And as he went
here
down the staircase, he felt something sharp on his left ankle. It was bleeding, and there was the ceramic lion just a couple of feet away from him. But this is also the staircase where the green slime was found, which George would collect and throw into the Amityville River. But he thought somebody was sneaking into the house and doing that. Downstairs, way down below there, the foyer, mm-hmm. when he would get down there, the music would stop, as he described it. But the furniture was pushed back up against.
And carpet was rolled, Tony.
And the carpets
really?
Were rolled up.
Yes.
As though somebody were actually marching there.
Now, in the second show that we're going to do. This is part one of the Amityville case.
Right, we couldn't
possibly. What are we going to be looking at? Can you tell us, Ed, what
we're going to be seeing these psychic pictures of a young man. It looks like a young man's face, but actually a diabolical face with luminescent eyes from one of the rooms that the children were murdered in.
Mm-hmm.
Then you'll see a photograph showing Padre Pio looking down at Lorraine while she's holding a relic of his. This was the room where the six bodies of the DeFeos were laid out.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll be going to some of the more terrifying experiences that we went through in that house.
As well as what became our scientific proof that they were telling the truth in that house.
Oh, yes.
Great. So we'll have a real exciting program
next week.
Now, as always, we'd like to reiterate, if someone, Lorraine, I'd like to ask this of you, mm-hmm. if someone needs your help, mm-hmm. if someone has a problem in their house, they think something's wrong.
Yes.
What how can they contact you? Can you tell us again how they can?
They can contact us by writing to us at Post Office Box 41, Monroe, Connecticut, 06468. Or if they even have questions, Tony, that they wish to have us answer that we didn't cover.
We'll be looking forward to our next program. So, tune in again for our next program, part two of the Amityville Horror. For Ed Warren, for Lorraine Warren, I'm Tony Sparrow. Good night.